Hi everyone, welcome to the Pink Wood Show. This is Anushree Deekshit. And before I introduce you to my mesmerizing guest, wait for a while. Today is somebody who is gifted. She is really blessed. She is talented, ravishing, and what not all. There are so many adjectives for her. Okay, you know, she made a debut with her film Sringaram and her first film bagged 3 national awards. Oh my God, isn't it something? Apart from that, she's been instrumental in encouraging the performance and encouraging fine arts. She's also associated with UNESCO. She's also been in the jury of 54th National Film Awards. So let me not waste much time and let me introduce you to Sharda Ramanathan. Hi, Sharda.
Hi. Can you hear me and see me?
Yes.
Fine, thank you. Can you hear me?
Yes, very well.
Hi, how are you?
I'm good, thank you. How are you?
Fine, thanks, Anushree. Lovely to see you and talk to you. Are we live on Facebook?
Yes, we are live.
Do people need the Zoom coordinates to watch on Facebook?
Yes, if they have to, they have to watch it on another window of Facebook. From Zoom.
Okay. Because many people don't have the Zoom coordinates. That's why.
Okay, so they can watch it on Facebook, the link that I shared.
All right. Okay. So, how are you?
I'm good, Sharda. So, tell me something about, like, you know, bagging the national awards in 3 categories. You know, it is something like, you know, beyond, you know, imagination. So how did you do it? I mean, had you ever, while you were making the film, did you ever think about it, that this could happen?
No, I'm not really, in the sense that when we were making the film, we were thinking more in terms of wanting to make a really good first film. That's all I was thinking about. But when we got people like Saroj Khan and Lalgudi Jayaraman and Madhu Amba to be part of the film, we used to joke about it. We used to tell Sri Lalgudi Jayaraman, who was the music director, we used to say, you know, Lalgudi ji, get ready with a nice kurta. You made such a beautiful song that you may have to go to Delhi. We used to joke about it to them, but never really thought that it would actually happen. But there were one or two technicians, senior people in the field from the industry who are used to winning national awards. And they won multiple awards and they used to joke with us saying that, oh my God, look at what Saroj Khan has done. Look at what Lalgudi ji has done. We're all not, you know, packing our bags to Delhi for sure this year. So that used to be a kind of an industry joke. But, you know, when it actually happens, then it's actually happened.
Yeah.
So then it was different. Yeah.
Right. So audience, we will have to wait for a moment for another video for you.
Sorry?
Another video.
Okay.
Tanani, tani, tani, nana, tani, 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 nana. Namaste, 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 namaste
வழிகள் தேவையா வீதிகள் தேவையா வழிகள் தேவையா இரு இதயம் சேர்ந்து பேசி பேசும் இரு இதயம் சேர்ந்து பேசி கொள்ள மொழிகள் தேவையா
ததானம் 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 தும் ததானம் 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 தும் ததானம் ததானம் தும் ததானம் ததானம் தும் ததானம் 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 தும் ததானம் தும் ததானம் தும் ததானம் 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 தும் ததானம் ததானம் தும் ததானம் ததானம்
ऐसे लहरा के तू रूबरू आ गई ऐसे लहरा के तू रूबरू आ गई धड़कने बेतहाशा तड़पने लगी धड़कने बेतहाशा तड़पने लगी तीर है सा लगा दर्द है सा जगा तीर है सा लगा दर्द है सा जगा छोट दिल पे वो खाई मजा गया मेरे रश के कमर
वो दैट वाज समथिंग शारदा
यू रियली डिड सम सॉलिड डिगिंग आई कैन सी दैट
I mean, your voice. Okay, but we'll come back to it. First, let us talk about Shringaram. Yeah. So, yeah. I see your Shringaram, and then I see Natya Nubhav. These are all based on dancing. So it looks like you are very much fascinated by dancing. Is that so?
You know, I've grown up in a family which is very steeped in the arts and everything, but I didn't do these films because they were about dance. I think I did these films because of the way they came to me, you know, as a subject. I mean, Shringaram was really about the Devadasi and about the fact that we had these extraordinary women who were feminists from the 6th century AD. We always associate Bharatanatyam with the Brahminical community, but look at who was actually dancing these dances at one time. They were not the Brahmins. They were other communities who were actually quite exotic and very strong. And so that's what attracted me to that subject. Natya Nubhava came purely by chance because it was something supported by the Ministry of External Affairs through the Public Service Broadcast, you know, Trust. And they just said, why don't you do this? And I said, okay. So they were very different efforts. Because one was a feature film, the other was a documentary.
Yes.
So they're two very different things. And Rudhir Tripangal is completely different.
Right, absolutely. Yeah. It's like child trafficking. So these are, okay, two were on similar lines. I'll say as a layman, but this film with Surveen Chawla you did, it was like on child trafficking, such a sensitive issue. So, you know, one is completely different from the other, sensitive, very sensitive and very rational and very practical, which is actually the prevalent scenario. So how did you switch your gears from that to this?
No, I don't think I switched gears. I think the common factor between the two was both are sensitive. I mean, the Devadasis, the whole concept of the Devadasi and the history and it's a very sensitive subject, actually. Even today, there's a lot of discussion and discourse around it. Child trafficking, I think it just came to me in a moment, you know, like I was talking to this very well-known theatre activist and director called Bansi Kaul, an old friend of mine. And he was running a theatre workshop and we were talking about, he said, kya yaar, hum, you know, we're saying we took loans from IMF and World Bank and the biggest loan we've taken is from the future generation. And we've taken a non-returnable loan from them. We're taking away their oxygen. We're taking away their water. We're even taking away their childhood. So it's just something that triggers something in you. And then I said, oh God, I want to do something with this. Because that's really what we are doing to our future, you know. So, and in these corona times, we really have to start thinking about how we want our future to look. you know, how did we come to this point? What are we leaving behind for that generation? What are we leaving behind for them? So I just think that everything I did was very relevant.
So I'm pretty intrigued by your choice of subjects, and I would really like to go back a little into time, like, you know, about your background, like, you know, how did you have this feeling, one, of being a film director, filmmaker, and the second is, you know, addressing the sensitive subjects?
Well, I think the first part, how did I want to be a filmmaker? I don't want to come up with, you know, usually when you ask people to go back in their lives, they'll create a big story, which probably isn't even true. So I don't have like this revolutionary moment when I said I want to be a filmmaker. It wasn't like that. For me, it was about getting ideas and finding the right medium for that idea. Like, there are some ideas which are really good as books. There are some ideas which would make good plays. A lot of the ideas that were getting generated in my head were making good films. You know, I was able to visualize them. And when you're making a film on dance, when it's about dance and music and Devadasi, it's very visual. It's not something that I want to write about. It's something that I want people to see. So that's how. And I also think, and from then on, I mean, you know, once you've been bitten by the bug, you're not going to give it up so easily.
Absolutely.
So I went on to do my next couple of films, yeah.
Great. So, you know, while you were on this, you know, journey, how did you, you know, there must have been a lot of challenges. How did you, you know, what were those challenges and how did you overcome those?
Oh my God, tell me a challenge that was not there. I mean, financially, of course, when in your first film, you're struggling for money on a daily basis. And then when you're making a period film as your first film, then you're struggling to make people understand how to be, you know, what you're supposed to be like at that time. And then there is a coterie, a bunch of people in the film industry who are looking at you and thinking, what is she doing? Why is she here? What can she do? You know, what is she capable of? And you're going to deal with that also. And then you don't come from a film family. So you have to navigate your way quite independently. So at every level, it was a challenge. It's not easy being a first timer of any kind in the film industry, whether it's an actor or director, technician, anything. You really have to really struggle is a part of what you do. It might look easy from the outside. It's really not. But it's worth the struggle if you can treat it as part of the adventure, you know.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So you always thought of being a filmmaker. That's what I think so. Yeah. Filmmaker or into films?
Yeah. I don't know. I think we all grew up, we are all part of the cinema theater generation, right? I mean, I'm not a millennial. Now we've got used to computers, etc. But it was very much a part of our outings. That's what we grew up with. So I think cinema is very much part of our psyche. I am a very visual person. I see things. Sometimes I see words. You know, I understand them visually sometimes. And now I feel my visual best is going to come only in the future. It's still going to come. This was part of the formative years. Now I'll put that into practice.
Okay. Lovely. And I would really like to know about, you know, are there any untold stories about you? I mean, untold stories about you? Yes, of course. Or maybe
about
you've experienced that not many people know.
There are lots of untold stories about me, which should remain untold. That's a different matter.
Okay, anyone that you would like to share with us and that must have left a great impact on you?
Yeah. There's one story, which is why me doing this chat with you in front of the camera is very special. And I'll tell you why. When I was in my first year of college, you know, I used to have a few friends who were already part of the film industry, who were also in college. So they said, you know, you look quite nice. Why don't you come in screen test? You know, and I didn't tell my parents, who would never have approved. So I just went for a screen test very big director. And I don't know whether the director will ever remember the story, but I do. And when he saw me come in, he looked really pleased. He said, okay, I think this is a good phase that I can launch. And then he put me in front of the camera.
Wow.
And his face just fell. Because he said, you know, till this point, till you came in front of the camera, I thought you were perfect. Once you were in front of the camera, I noticed everything is wrong with your face for camera. Your features are not proportionate. You know, you've got really fat cheeks and et cetera, et cetera. So now that's a really good reason why I'm on the other side of the camera, never on this side. So there's something called a camera face.
Okay.
I'm not one of those.
And do you really believe in it? Because, the conventional thinking has now drastically changed. So do you now really believe in it? Because we have so many actresses. Rather, we used to take inspirations. And if you ask about me and many theater artists like me, we used to take inspirations from the actresses from the South who don't have, they have got, you know, a mass, you know. So people are so inspired. So do you really believe in it?
No, I think there is something called a camera face, and it's not a stereotype. It's just, you know, when a face is in front of the camera, it has to be able to carry off being a character in front of the camera. It has to be able to express all those things that the character needs to express as part of the narrative. Not every face can do that, you know. And there are some faces which are meant only for the stage, which should not be in. So you have different faces, different personalities for different mediums. So and there are some people who became inspirations for writers who wrote books. You know, I have an uncle who became an inspiration for one of Naipaul's books years ago. I don't think he would have made the cut on screen or on stage. But I'm just saying, so different personalities suit different mediums, you know. So you can't, it still exists. It's not a stereotype, but it's a suitability. It's a compatibility with the medium.
Right.
And there are some faces that the camera absolutely loves. You know, whatever they do, they look nice in front of the camera. They may not look the same outside. And that's okay. I think these are different mediums, different lenses. And you have different kinds of people who fit these different mediums. And that's okay.
Yeah, that's something I think today I've got that concept. Otherwise, I used to, you know, feel about this thinking of people, that how could people be so mean, or how could they think about, you know, this conventional looks that we've been talking about. But yes, the suitability that you are saying, I think, that opens my eyes and gets me a fact.
Yeah.
Okay. You know, in the life, we always have done something, or we keep doing things that we know we are right. But it's not important that everyone thinks the same way. Like, there are so many reformers who thought that things were not going in the right way. So they were called, you know, the rebels or the reformers. Yeah. Have you done any such thing that you are unapologetic about?
Yeah, I think most of my life, I mean, I've been, but I think when you, I'm uncomfortable talking about myself in that context, because when you are trying to make a change somewhere or in somebody's life, it's not about yourself, it's about the other person. Or it's even today, I think all of us are trying to deal with the crisis that we're going through. And on a daily basis, I'm coordinating all kinds of activities for people who are desolate, for people who are stranded, for people. But I'm not sure that I want to talk about it. And I don't know, I'm not a revolutionary reformer, if that's what you're asking. But I think my heart is in the right place. And I think I'm sort of, my understanding is something that I'm not apologetic about. Wrong is wrong, right is right, and that's just the way it is, you know. So I don't think, I mean, for example, I've been part of this Picnic movement years and years ago, you know, in the 80s. And I was part of the team that started it, like a cultural renaissance movement, helped start it in Tamil Nadu, for example. But can I say that I did it? I don't know. I don't think any individual does it on their own. Something drives, something triggers, you know. For example, my next movie, I'm not going to tell you exactly what it is, but it's about, and I'm going to start shooting as soon as Corona allows us to, but it's about this person. I'm not even going to say boy or girl.
Okay.
This person who was very much a part of a huge historical freedom movement, not Indian, but she was an Indian. Oh, I said she. Okay. And, you know, when you think about movements, they are usually associated with certain people, you know, like Indian freedom movement, you think of Gandhi and Netaji, and et cetera, et cetera. But there are so many moments and so many people who are part of that historical moment. It takes an ocean of moments to create that phenomenon. And some of those stories are just so brilliant. And history has never recorded those moments. History has never done that. You always, history has been very simple, you know. It hasn't told you those millions of stories which are so epic and so fantastic. So my future film is about one such story. So I always think that when something happens, when there is that fantastic moment, we think we did it, but actually we didn't. There were a whole bunch of people and, you know, your planets have to be aligned. So all that has to be in place for that thing to happen. So something else is driving it. It's always a collective. I don't believe one person can do it. So I don't think of myself as somebody who created something or reformed something. I think of myself always as part of a larger moment, if ever I was there, you know?
I'm sure. And I think that this, you are saying that you're not revolutionary, but still you have touched the subjects. You know, maybe your work is going to speak. It has spoken and it is definitely going to speak. We expect a lot from
you. There's a lot more to speak, don't you worry. Yeah.
Okay. Okay. So, you know, this passion in your work, how passionate are you about this work?
About?
This work. Filmmaking. Movies? Yes, the movies.
I think I am very, very passionate. But I think the passion, for me, cinema is a medium. It is an art form. I mean, when you're making a film, you're making a film. You're not writing a book. You're not writing a play, right? So there is something called being cinematic. And I'm a great believer of that. I don't believe that you should write manuscripts on screen or make a manuscript cinematic. I think each medium has its own language. So from that point of view, I think it's an art form. It's a technical art form. But I also think that what drives me is the idea. I think what the world needs is a lot more ideation. Because now everybody knows how to make a film. Everyone's picking up the iPhone and shooting something and editing. And everybody knows the technical aspects of how it's done. What is it that you're bringing to it as a filmmaker? What is the story you're telling? And how are you telling it in a way that it adds that one more insight to the audience? You know, like they say, love stories never go out of fashion. And yet every time there's a love story, it looks different. Because it's coming from a different mind, a different idea, a different storyteller. So I think it's like that. So I think for me, the passion is about telling the story. The craft is the medium. But telling the story and creating an experience is the real end of what you're doing.
Yeah. Absolutely right. Absolutely right. It is more of a storytelling. It is more of sharing one's experiences, sharing what the thoughts are. But yes, that's very rightly said.
Yeah.
Okay. So what about you've already given a little, you know, thrown some light. Could you share some unforgettable experiences at work?
At work?
Yeah.
Oh, plenty. I must tell you, when I was, I can tell you some funny stories.
Yes, please.
You know, when we were shooting Shringaram, for example, there was one scene when the princely, the zamindar, comes into the room for his first night with the Devadasi. So I was like pushing Aditi to be really, really coy in that scene, you know. And at that point, Aditi was so-called, you know, attached. She had a partner in her life. So I was pushing her to be really, really coy. And I kept pushing. And at one point, you know, the other actor in the scene was Manoj K. Jayan, who acted as the princely landlord. He's a very established Malayalam actor. So at one point, he came and tapped on my shoulder and he said, "Madam, I want to remind you about something." I said, "What is it, Manoj sir?" He said, "You're the only one in this room who's single. And you are trying to teach us to do this scene. You're the only one who has no experience in what this means." So we all had a good laugh about that. Because I was literally the only one in the room who didn't have a partner, who wasn't married or anything. And I was trying to teach them to be like that. So, I mean, there are many such instances. So, you know, shooting is always sometimes a hysterical experience behind the curtain.
Okay, yeah, absolutely. You know, life, you know, we always say that when life gives us lemons, make a lemonade out of it. So, any such experience you had?
Making a lemonade out of life. Yeah. I make lemonade out of lemons, but I don't know what that really means. I have no idea what that means. But the only thing that I can say is that, you know, I don't know if this sounds too philosophical, but we're really living through times which are making me believe in Kali Yuga a lot. I mean, there's so much going wrong. It's like a world gone horribly wrong. And I think the only way to jump into it is to tell yourself there's a great opportunity to set a few things right before you pass on. You know, it's like an opportunity for us to participate in stuff that can set things right. In a way, you know, my next film has become more relevant to me now. Because when I started researching it and writing it, I thought it was a story that resonated to today, but still very much a story of yesterday. But now I'm beginning to feel that it's speaks to today. I'm making it with an emotional connect to today's narrative. I can't wait to show it to you, but I haven't even started shooting. So, but you'll see it next year.
Wow.
2020 is not our year.
Yeah. Eagerly waiting for it. And 2020, yes.
Hi guys, I can see 3-4 people who logged in. My friend
Molly
is here. Yeah.
There are many people. Right, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So, We have a few questions from a few people who've joined here. Mr. Ram Bala Subramaniam, he would like to ask you some question.
Sure.
So, hello, Mr. Ram Bala Subramaniam.
Is he here?
Hello. Are you there? Hello.
Is that him?
Hello. Mr. Ram, can you hear us? Hello? I think he's not able to hear us.
Yeah.
Can you hear? Okay. We have a question here on Facebook Live.
Yeah.
Okay. Kya small, choti poems haath se likhe gaane liye ja sakte hain aapke production mein? Okay.
Please translate that for me.
Okay. I mean, they are writing, I mean, they are not very established writers probably. That's what they want to say. And but they have some written thing. So how to approach you to share their work with
okay.
you?
Okay. Good question. One of the things that I have done is we have set up a production company in Chennai. And when this crisis is through, when it's over, we do want to get into production, not just what I direct, but actually get into solid production. We already have people who have sort of messaged me on Facebook and everything. One of my principles is don't turn anyone away. You know, that's just a horrible thing to do. But we still don't have the infrastructure to entertain too many ideas right now. Once we have a structure in place, which will be towards October, November, then we will start entertaining ideas. We will try and enable as many writers, filmmakers, actors, etc., as we can. There's only this much that one production house will be able to do. But that's something that we intend to do from October, November. Something we would have liked to start in the summer, but we couldn't because of what is going on. So we'll start that towards the end of the year. And I think 2021, we'll try and be as creatively enabling as we can. The production house is called Tani Tirai Productions. Tani means unique. Tirai means cream. It's a Tamil word. Yeah. But it sounds very Spanish. It's got an international tinge. We call it Tani Tirai Productions.
Yeah. Wow. Okay, we have a question from Rohit. So Rohit, I'm unmuting you. You can go ahead with the question.
I don't see him.
Yeah, he switched off his camera.
Okay.
Rohit, have you muted yourself?
I can't see his question on the chat.
Yeah.
Why would some look different in camera and in real? What are the ways to improve and any tips? That's his question, right?
Rohit, yeah, Thomas. That's right. Yeah.
So, I don't know if you can hear me, but I think up to a point you can fashion yourself to, I don't know if there is any one look for the camera. I don't think it's about that. I think the camera needs a certain basic kind of face. It can be dark, it can be fair, it can be black, it can be white, it can be gray. I don't think... it's not color specific, it's not feature specific. It's just that you have to be expressive in front of the camera. And if you've got really, really, really small eyes, and there's a certain way in which you have to learn to use it to be expressive. If you've got like really thick lips, then you have to find a way of using that to express when you're crying or laughing or being natural. So I think it's a question of knowing how to use your face in front of the camera, because the camera captures much more intimately than when you're on stage. It's not like theater. So, and that's why I think one of the good things that's happened in cinema is all kinds of faces have started appearing on screen. Some really natural dusky beauties, and you know, a whole range of sort of earthy cinema. That's what I call it. A lot of earthy cinema we have now. So many of my main characters in my next film are very earthy. So that's nice. I think that's great. Some people have really big eyes, but they know how to use it. So I think it's about developing the skill to use your face to be in front of the camera. And there are acting classes, and you know, there are schools that that are everywhere. I think even in Chennai, there's BAFTA, there's, I think, Whistling Woods and other acting classes in Mumbai. So I think it's worth going to acting classes to be able to acquire that skill. I don't see Rohit yet, but it's okay. I think he's got my answer. Yeah.
B. Ram Subramaniam, I am unmuting you. Yes.
Vanakkam Sharada ji.
Vanakkam.
My name is Rama Subramaniam, and I am... you know, father of Runjun.
Sorry?
Okay. Please go ahead with the question.
Okay. There are three songs. That is Malari and Nidaiwal.
Yeah.
And that folk song. Idhu vandu Chandrasekhar. See, can I talk to you in Tamil?
I don't think the others will understand.
Yeah.
Okay. The thing is, shooting with Chandrasekhar and YGM is not a problem. But shooting with Aditya Rao Aidari and other people, you might be having some problem.
What kind of problem do you see?
The thing is, language and other things.
Yeah.
See, the thing is, what you wanted to convey, they may not be able to understand that much. I mean, you know.
No, I think you're right. Language can be a problem when they don't know the language. But having said that, I think they worked really hard to understand the words, to understand the dialogues. And it was Aditi's first effort ever on screen. So it really wasn't easy, but she's extremely competent. She's a very competent actor, and she's very hardworking. That was my experience with her in that film. And she would sit and learn her lines, understand the intonation. She would say it in English, then say it back. And so we worked really hard on the dialogues. So by the time we went to take a shot, by the time we blocked the shot, she kind of knew her lines. So she was able to say it with a lot more expression because she had rehearsed. I think cinema is about rehearsing a lot without losing the freshness of the moment. It's a challenge to do that. Because on the one hand, you're repeating yourself, but you want to get fresher and fresher. It's a kind of a paradox, but it worked well. It was good.
Great, that's nice. So we have over here on Facebook another question from Ilami Dilip Kumar. She says, congratulations, ma'am. Glad to join you. What made you to choose this profession? Being a woman, it's really tough. That too from a South Indian family. Okay, so that background, did that ever, came in between your dream?
Yeah.
And you?
Okay, first of all, I don't know why it should be a problem because I'm a South Indian family. I don't know what your impression of South Indian families are.
She herself is a South Indian.
Maybe in South India, you come from a conservative family. I don't know. But honestly, I think for women in general, there are lots of issues within patriarchy. But I must say that I have personally not faced any issues. I don't want to mix the two. I do recognize that patriarchy plays a big role in how women are perceived, how women are treated, how women are empowered, etc. But for me personally, I cannot lie. I never really had a problem as a woman. I think I had other kinds of struggles which all first-time filmmakers have, but not because I was a woman. In fact, I'd like to treat my experience as an example of how women need not be harassed when they want to choose a certain profession. But I must also say here that I'm not a careerist. I don't wear this profession in my sleeve. I'm not even sure that I believe in the concept of profession. I think you should do anything that you want to do based on a certain idea, based on a certain larger worldview or perspective that you want to communicate. I don't think you should become a professional beast or a professional creature. Because I'm making movies, there are some things that I have to do, like pick up the craft. I have to understand the different departments. I have to understand how production works so that filmmaking becomes an efficient effort for me and for everybody else who works with me. But I've never really stuck to any profession too long. Although I think I will keep making films till I die. But I may also write a book. I may also direct a Broadway show. I may want to do something like that. It depends on where the idea takes me. Clearly, I am going to make another 3 films which are already planned. Mm-hmm. But that's because I want to make those films and I want to use the film medium. So I cannot say that it was difficult for me. But yes, it is difficult for a lot of men and women to get into this profession. But cinema, you know, we keep talking about the dark side of cinema. There's also a bright side to it.
There is, of course.
It's also a place where people don't worry about which religion you're from, which caste you're from. They don't really worry about things like that. It is it is one of the most secular spaces, I think.
Right. Absolutely.
And I think we must give it credit for that too. It's not all about the bad news. Of course, we need to sort out the bad news, but there's a lot of good news that comes out of industry.
Yes, that's a brighter side that you are showing, and yes, and the kind of oneness we have. We are all united by our work, our passion in the industry, and I think they are like if we talk about one aspect, that is intercaste, inter-religion marriages. That's the most that is the example, and we take inspirations from there. And it's been, it was the times, older times, when things were quite rigid and conservative. So, by the way, relating to this question, I have this thing in mind. That do you think cinema, we always say it's a mirror of the society, but don't you think that there is also a little bit of spice in it, and that makes it exaggerate a little more, especially if I talk about the issues?
Well, forget about cinema, Anushree. When you go out and you have some strange experience, very inane experience, you go shopping and you bump into some stranger and then you come home and you narrate the story, do you not exaggerate it a little? I think exaggeration is very much a part of storytelling. But in exaggerating, you mustn't distort the facts, is what I think, you know. So exaggeration in itself is not a problem. It's very much a part of human nature because it's part of storytelling. But you don't have to compromise the authenticity of the story or of the moment that you're trying to communicate. You're just making it more interesting. I mean, imagine food without salt.
Absolutely. Right. But then sometimes what happens, how true it is, like the filmmakers, they try to, you know, distort the facts or play with the facts. And nowadays, there is a trend we see that whatever movie is being made, there is some controversy attached to it. And people often say that it is, you know, playing with the religious sentiments or with the history. What do you have to say about it?
Yeah, I think it works both ways. I mean, on the one hand, you can make a completely fictional film. And then on the other hand, you can make a film that's based on some kind of history. I think too much of distortion is also makes me uncomfortable. When you distort it too much to suit a certain narrative, that does make me uncomfortable. But having said that, I think you can criticize it, critique it, but to be intolerant, I think intolerance has, and most of these intolerant sections themselves wouldn't have read that part of history. So I think the intolerance does not come from an informed space. It comes from a space of agendas. It comes from a space where people want to, you know, go and make a statement, to make themselves visible, to promote themselves in these kind of perverse ways. So I think there's something unhealthy on both extremes. On the one hand, you can't do whatever you want with history. You have to have some sense of trueness to it. Having said that, if it's distorted, then you can come out and say that it's distorted. You don't have to go and create damage and, you know, create harm. And you don't have to become a dangerous person in order to be able to critique it. So I think critique is important, not agendas and intolerance. I think that is wrong.
That's absolutely right. And we have another question from Venkat Rajan. So I'm unmuting you, Venkat Rajan.
Sure.
Yeah.
Hi. Hi, Sharda. Good to see you finally after Facebook.
Yeah, he's my favorite friend. Yeah.
yeah. Good. So I also come from filmy, some family members connected to films. And right. I always had the passion to make movies, write stories. And, So launched a book also called The Mud Elephant. It's a fiction which I launched 5 years back. You know, it's about caste conflict set in South India. Firstly, congratulations for your 3 national awards. I know you won, but I didn't know 3 awards which I got to know today. Good. And the OTT platform, which is going to, you know, be the, you know, medium of distribution, you know. How is it going to influence? You know, I see that, as you said in this call also, that anybody can make a movie today, and you know the technicalities, and the distribution platforms are also easily available today, you know, as long as they're pretty decent, you know. The storytelling pattern, is it going to change the way, because, you know, the big screen, silver screen agenda was different, you know, largely, you know, you had space to create those effects and all that, you know. Suddenly, you know, you can do it cheaper, constrained, and also cost-effective and deliver it quickly.
I understand your question.
Yeah,
I think there are 2 or 3 things to this, Venkat. One is that the most important thing about what we are going through now is the most unpredictable thing of the future is human behavior. We have no idea how people are going to come out of this individually and collectively. We have to wait and see how it pans out. Having said that, I think it is in the nature of the human beast to want to go out, to want to have a picnic, to want to go watch a movie, to want to go to the park. People like going out, go to the beach, whatever. So I think that habit is going to come back. I don't think it's going to go away. It might take a year, might take 6 months. I mean, even during the pandemic, people were thronging the beaches of America. And it was very frustrating for the authorities because nobody was actually respecting the law. Many people were not respecting the lockdown. The beaches were quite busy. So it is the nature of the human beast to want to go out. But I also want to say that this OTT versus cinema halls is something that is not this pandemic specific. I think we have reached a point where when you make a film, you kind of figure out whether this will be good for the big screen or whether this will be a nicer watch on Amazon or Netflix or as a series or whatever. In my head, I've already started making that distinction. So on the one hand, I'm preparing to shoot a film because I know my next film is this big canvas, epic, you know, it's got big rallies, lack of people. And, you know, what I'm saying is it's the big canvas political movement film. So it gives me the opportunity to make it magical and mesmerizing on the big screen. But I'm also planning for another bunch of stories to go as a web series. So I think that differentiation, you will not want to watch. Your first watch of Avatar would never have been on OTT. You would have wanted it to be a big screen experience, you know, or even Bahubali. Your first watch cannot be on the small screen. You would have wanted to see it on the big screen. So I think there are certain kinds of films which are for the big screen and certain kinds of narratives which will work better as tele. What used to be telefilms is now moving to OTT. There were some films that, you know, HBO and others have been producing telefilms for the longest time. They were not films for the big screen. So I don't think this is new. I think we're just overreacting because of the fear that theaters may close down. I don't think they'll close down. I think people will always want to go out. People will always want to get that immersive experience. So, and there's only this much you can do sitting at home, you know. And housewives are going to want to go out, trust me. They don't want to be.
Of course. I can completely relate with you. Okay, we'll take one last question from the audience. It's Ravi. So, Ravi, I'm unmuting you. Yes, please go ahead. Can't hear you. No, we cannot hear you, Ravi.
Can you take the question and send it?
Yeah, I'll take the question. Okay, so he's saying, can you make a film for movement against addiction to alcohol? Okay.
Wow. I think Devdas was about that. Addiction to alcohol. I don't know. I mean, it depends. Everybody is concerned about it as an issue. But I must say that when you make a film, the idea that triggers you to make a film is not necessarily only because it's socially relevant, but also because it's an idea that in your head translates into a visual narrative. Until that happens, I won't make a film on any subject. But as an issue, I understand. It's an important issue, and I'm sure someone out there will pick up on this and probably make a film on it. But there have been films on alcoholism. They may not have been the main dominant theme of the film, but they have been dominant factors in the destruction of the protagonist to something in the past. I mean, I think Sharabi wasn't he an alcoholic or something?
It was, yes.
Yeah, and in Devdas, he was an alcoholic, which really spelt doom for him. I'm just saying that I've been commercial films that have dealt with it in different ways. But I won't say never. I mean, who knows? Maybe one day I will do it. If I feel that I'm capable of converting that into a visual narrative, then I'll do it. But somebody else might do it before I do.
Okay, and let's talk about the singing, singing part, your hobby.
Oh, gosh.
So, I mean, you've sung, you've recorded, and it was uploaded on YouTube. So, I mean, what about singing? I mean, how passionate are you about it?
Oh my God, I always wanted to be a singer.
Oh!
Yeah, because I come from a family of singers. We just sing for no reason in my family.
Wow.
In the house, we sing every 2 hours. We find a reason to sing. So, and my couple of my family members have gone on to become quite well-known singers. everybody sings beautifully at home. I'm not the best singer, but somehow it never happened. I may not have wanted to be a performer, but I definitely wanted to be a singer because there are so many thoughts in my head which don't come out in my voice. But I'm saying musical thoughts. But I hope to compensate for it by working passionately on the music of my films. Because I really, really, and for me, music is, and rhythm and melody is the, is where ideas also come from. I mean, when you look at a film, it has a rhythm, the film has a melody. You know, the, every film has its own pace. What is pace? It's rhythm. So I'm a big, it's in my blood. So I sing for a lark. I'm not a professional singer.
Right, and we will not let you go without that. But okay, yes. But before that, how about, you know, entering into Bollywood?
Sorry,
Bollywood. Your idea of Bollywood. Are you
definitely going to? Yeah, I have to make that one Bollywood film in my life for sure. It'll probably happen after my next film. That's definitely happening.
Wow,
I'm talking about that. And I will not do it without a solid, you know, star cast and all that. So that's going to happen. I'm a great believer that every filmmaker should make that one Bollywood film at least.
Absolutely. Okay. What about, I don't know if it's true or not. I've heard somewhere that you're working on an international film. So when
that's
can
the one I've
that?
Been talking about. Yeah, that's the one about the freedom struggle thing.
Okay.
It's an international film. Uh-huh. The entire film is going to be shot. Okay, let me just say this much. The entire film is going to be shot in South Africa.
Okay.
And it's embedded within the resistance of South Africa.
Oh.
So we've been researching this for the last 1.5-2 years. And we've done the script. And my scriptwriter currently is a very successful Kollywood scriptwriter called Rajesh, Karandil Rajesh. So we're working together.
Lovely.
And I also have a dialogue writer from, so it's a cross-country thing. So whenever the flights open, I have to take a flight and go there.
Okay, now when you've talked about, but before that, we are really looking forward to that project of yours. When we are talking about the research part, like, how do you research for the films, the scripts, the authenticity?
Yeah, that's a good question, actually. I mean, for some reason, for all my 3 films, I've had to research. Shringaram had needed a lot of research because I've never lived through the Devadasi times. So I went and met a couple of Devadasis, the last of the living Devadasis. One of them was already 100 when I met her. To spend time with them, travel, read books. I had a scholar who had done her PhD on the Devadasi system, Dr. Bhavani, who worked with me on the research. Had Indira Soundarajan, who's very well known for his cultural history. He's a cultural history expert and writer, who was my writer for the film. So the entire team was very embedded within research and history for that film. Even for Pudhiya Tirupangal, which is about child trafficking, I've never met a child trafficker in my life. So I actually had to go to prison and meet some of them.
Oh.
It's a very difficult thing to do. Because, you know, you have a certain sense of how they might look and how they work. It's really not how they are. These are guys who like to go to fashion stores, buy good clothes. They're like you and me. Having said that, because they're constantly in that underbelly of your city and of your town, they live the dark life, that also becomes a part of their personality. And they are very filmy, you know, because when they are constantly living in that darker side of society, they love to watch movies. I'm talking about the ones that I met in prison. And many of them, for some reason, have no remorse. Some of them do, but many of them have become dehumanized. So I had to go and research that too. And I came back thinking they're not at all what I thought they were, you know. So even for the film that I'm going to be shooting as soon as lockdown is done, we've researched for almost 1.5 years. We've found the families of the protagonists of the films. talked to them, got a lot of oral narratives from them, met so many scholars and, you know, so many people who came from that tradition of resistance. It was fantastic. I had a research associate with me, Dr. Maya Ratnam, who's a PhD in anthropology. So it was serious research. But again, it was research. Somewhere at the back of my head, it was also research for a film. So part of the research was generic, but part of it was also, I used to keep seeing it and visualizing it, you know. So there's a certain body language to them. There were certain mannerisms that they had. So you have to also think about those things when you're researching.
Right.
You have to think about the visualization of it when you're researching. Which makes it quite quirky for the person who's talking to you. You go and ask a family member, so did she have a twitch? Or did he scratch his head? You don't know what their personal characteristics were. So you need to know those things also.
Right.
It's a very different kind of research. It's not just academic research.
Absolutely.
We don't say, you know, we've scripted and we're ready to fly, but we're grounded now.
And how about the authenticity part? I mean, how do you ensure if it's authentic or not?
You know, that's a good question, because if I were to make a film on Gandhi or Nehru, there's a lot of documentation, right? Dr. Ambedkar or whatever. This is not about that. This is about the invisible person.
Right.
Right? So you have to connect the dots. The dots are available. So when you're connecting the dots, you have to interpret. You cannot imagine. You have to, there's a big difference between interpretation and imagination. You have to, it has to be plausible. This is how it could have happened, is how you have to connect the dots. So that is a very, very challenging task. But much of it comes also from oral histories, you know, from the families, from the descendants, from people who knew, you know, their grandfathers or great grandfathers or whatever. So I think it comes through that. We make it happen, but you have to be very careful how you do this.
And when it comes to, you know, there are two, there are many aspects of filmmaking, but like if I majorly talk about scripting, research, okay, the script and the making of the film. So, you know, how important is each element?
How important is
something? How important is both of them, like script and filmmaking?
Oh, yeah. I think the script, see, you start with the idea, then it unfolds into a script. Then your script completely changes when you do screenplay.
Yes,
changes
absolutely.
Not in terms of the basic narrative,
right?
But you start visualizing it. So when you visualize it, some of what you write may not be how it would have happened. When you say somebody ran, right? There's only this much you can describe it on paper.
Right.
You can say that they ran, you can say that they ran fast. But when the person actually ran, maybe that person is running away from something terrible. What are the ways in which a person runs away from something really terrible? So I think the screenplay, it could be gawky, it could be they fell once, got up and still ran. There are so many little things that come into it. Then the final output is when the person is actually running on set when you're shooting. There are some things that might happen which may be wrong for that moment. Some things which inadvertently happen, which may be so right for the moment that you never thought of. So I think there is that movement from script to screenplay, which is one of the most crucial transitions in the making of the film.
Yeah. Right. And one last question related to this is that, you know, a message for the newcomers, like, do you think they should be joining any such institutes where they offer filmmaking courses?
I myself a newcomer, but I think the only thing that I will say to newcomers is what will finally make you click, really, unless you're lucky, is a really, really powerful idea that comes from a really, really powerful worldview. I think that, because today there's a lot of emphasis on content and a lot of the cinema that's coming out. You know, I've been seeing a lot more Tamil films also of late. It's very, very gut, very hard-hitting, very, authenticity can also be very, you know, can really hit you at the gut sometimes. So, and people are really, really focusing on content. I think there is a strange kind of intelligence wave that we are going through, where people really don't want to suffer fools on screen. You know, they want to see something that speaks to them in some meaningful way. It could be through irreverence, it could be through, you know, and a lot of the films 50 years ago would have been like documentaries. You know, when you look at some films today, there's a film called Super Deluxe, you know, with Vijay Sethupathi and a little child. 20 years ago, that would have been made as a documentary, because it's really about the traveling with the relationship of these two people, which is not how cinema used to be earlier. So I think there's a sense of experience, meaningful experience people want. So my only suggestion, I can't say advice, but my only suggestion to young filmmakers is stick to developing, keep growing here, keep seeing things here, keep watching, listening, and then develop your ideas and narratives. Very unlikely that you'll fail if you do that. And be very, very sensitive to the craft. Don't use it crassly. Use it nicely. Use it skillfully. Use it artfully. I think marry these two things, you're on your way.
Absolutely. Okay, and before we go, as I said, you will have to sing a song for us. No, we can't let you go like that.
I can't just sing.
No, please.
I'm not a singer.
No, it's fine.
One line, okay, just for the heck of it.
All right.
A Hindi song, yeah? I don't know which one though. Mere maula karam ho karam. मेरे मौला करम हो करम मेरे मौला करम हो करम मेरे मौला करम हो करम That's it.
Oh, mesmerizing voice, heart touching, beautiful, and we see the audience clapping for you.
Oh no.
Wonderful. So, Sharda, it was such wonderful talking to you. It was such a pleasure to have you. And let me tell you. Hello?
I said you too.
Thank you. And, you know, it was one of the best interviews, the most enriching interviews, value addition that you've given today. I mean, it's so beautiful. And thank you so much for being here. Amazing. And we were really sometimes spellbound while hearing you. And there is one, not a question, a compliment. Thank you for your answer. That was an eye-opening answer. Oh. So that the one for family one that you gave. So
thank you, Anushree.
So thank you so
bye
much.
Bye-bye, everyone. I don't know whether to say stay home, stay safe, but keep everyone around you safe, especially those who are stranded on the streets. Okay.
Absolutely. Bye-bye. And bye. Thank you so much once again. Thank you, audience. Thank you, everyone.
Bye-bye.